Good afternoon, everyone on the East Coast. Good evening to anybody outside, I guess, in Europe, and good morning to people on the West Coast. I am Paul Johnson. I'm the Executive Director of the Gabelli School, the Gabelli Center for Global Security Analysis. It is my pleasure to welcome you on behalf of our two partners, the Museum of American Finance and the CFA Society of New York. Our goal with these programs is to bring you renowned experts from many different fields to speak on topics and issues that are relevant to the economy, to the market, and to you. Our speaker today is Rob Lalka. He's the Albert R. Lepage Professor in Business at Tulane University's A.B. Freeman School of Business. Rob is the author of the critically acclaimed and recently published The Venture Alchemist, How Big Tech Turned Profits into Power. After my discussion with Rob, I'll be joined by David Cowan, president of the Museum of American Finance, for a Q&A session with the audience. Please submit your questions at any time throughout the discussion with the tab at the bottom of your screen. All attendees today in today's event will be offered a free digital copy of the book with information coming to you following our event. Now I would like to introduce our speaker, Rob. I was looking at his bio and it's too long to read it all because we wouldn't have any time to talk to him. It's very impressive. Rob has achieved numerous awards, both in his writing and his teaching. And as a fellow teacher, I was very impressed with the teaching awards. He's clearly a very passionate teacher. I think that will come through in our discussion. I think you may even talk about it. But the book itself was just named one of the best books in business of 2024 by the Society for Advancing Business Editing and Writing. And the Kirkus Review called it an impressive work of research and intellectual reflection. Adding to this praise, the body of work addressing this subject now seems inexhaustible, but this book must count as among its most clear-eyed, well-researched, and morally uncompromising examples. A fancy way of saying the book is excellent. On top of that, the book is incredibly timely, as you will see. So it is with great pleasure that I get to have this conversation with Rob. I started reading the book in anticipation of this event and couldn't put it down. It is both incredibly well-researched and enlightening, as well as disturbing. I found it mesmerizing, and the work you put into it was extremely impressive. The stories are great. But the consequences are serious and important, and I think we'll draw that out today. All right, Rob, welcome. Great to have you. All right, Rob, I'm going to start with a kind of an open-ended question because this, as I was reading the book and really impressed with the amount of work you put into it, I kept saying, wait, what prompted you to write? Thank you. I'm happy you did. I'm very happy you did. And I think we all should be happy you did it, but how come?
Thanks, Paul. And thanks to Fordham. Thanks to the museum. Thanks to the CFA group for pulling this all together. It's gonna be a great discussion. I was just following a lot of these trends that we talk about in the book and that we're gonna go through. And I was both interested, curious, concerned. As someone who teaches venture capital, I understand more about how it works than the average person. As someone who supports student entrepreneurs, I care about them building businesses that are going to make a positive impact on our world, that are going to make the world a better place, and also going to make them a lot of money. And I realized my students had this really strange view of these companies. Now, we're going to be talking about Meta, which is, of course, Facebook, WhatsApp, Instagram, PayPal, Palantir, Google, Alphabet is the parent company there, Uber. You know, they have these very strange ideas, not only about the companies themselves, but about the people who started them, as if they're superhuman, as if they are on these hero's journeys where my students think I could never do that because I never had that lightning in a bottle. You know, I never had that moment. I never had that sort of epiphany. And, you know, for me as someone who's, I'm 41 years old, I've watched these companies grow up throughout my life. I realize these are flawed human beings who are making choices at the helm of each of these companies. and the investors, through the way venture capital works, had certain incentives. And the entrepreneurs figured it out, and they often made trade-offs that didn't fit with their original intentions. Or as they went, they made moral trade-offs that you and I probably wouldn't make. And so trying to understand these entrepreneurs as human beings was really where I began the work for my students. And one of the things I begin with at the very beginning, and I'm so glad that the audience today is going to have a copy of the book so they can delve into it. But I really did try to shed more light than heat. And that's a phrase that really stuck with me as I was thinking about the purpose of my work in the world as a university professor, to shed more light, to seek the truth. And also to think about how overheated often our discussions are about technology or about politics, about the workings of some of these iconic people that were, they've gone from being sort of the heroes and hoodies to being vilified. And I don't think either one's right. And I really wanted to spend time to humanize them, to tell their real stories, and to deeply research it so that they would, my students would have that repository of information that they could go deeper on. And now the audience for this event and others will as well. And so really looking forward to the conversation with you today on sort of what that all teaches, what we can learn from it, and what we should do about it.
Rob, as I had hoped, that tees up a couple of questions. Maybe just go in my sense of the chronological order of the evolution of the book. You're teaching entrepreneurship, you're teaching venture capital. It's clearly, for a lot of students, a very attractive career opportunity. And you want to create a profile. What do these entrepreneurs look like? What are they like? Make them human, but more than make them human, kind of bring them back to the students, so the students might be able to identify with certain traits or characteristics, and maybe make it so that they're not so superhuman that we don't even try, because, boy, I'm not like Elon, so I'm not going to go. It sounds like that was kind of step one, really get some profiles, be able to link those profiles back to the students to give them kind of a path forward, if you will. Is that fair?
That's absolutely fair. Yeah, I mean, this book is the product of somebody who was at Yale University and was one of the first people on Facebook, on thefacebook.com, and was debating in the dining hall what it was doing to our conversations and what it was, whether it was even a real business or whether it was just a joke, whether it was just a fun thing that was not even worth our time, or something that was just something that was just a strange phenomenon that would fade. And that's what's interesting about the early chapters of the book, is that I go back to, I actually went through all the college newspapers as thefacebook.com was hitting their campuses. And I tried to study what were people's reactions or early on. There were some amazing early warnings. You have a lot of people who are really worried about what it means for us to be putting our identities online and investing in our self-worth through that image that we're creating, rather than really being in person and meeting people in real dialogue. All those early warnings proved they were foretelling a lot of the things that we're really worried about now, that our children are experiencing about what does it mean for your body image? What does it mean for your self-worth? What does it mean for, the Surgeon General is warning that this is changing the way that our children's brains are developing, and that it is literally rewiring the way that their brains, as they're trying to understand their identity and self-worth, are processing who they are and how they should work in the world. That is all very concerning to me as that of now a 4 and 7-year-old. But it's also concerning to me because we act like it was inevitable that we would get here. And my point in the book is that that's absolutely not true, that there were choices that were made, and that there are admissions that if you listen very closely to what these people have said, there are admissions, there are confessions about how we got here, because it was on purpose in many cases. John Parker, the first CEO of Facebook, said, "We hacked their brains. It's exactly something that a hacker like me would have come up with," is what he told Mike Allen. He said it was a way to hack psychology so that you're the infinite scroll and the dopamine where you're checking the notifications, all of that was on purpose to get you to keep using the platform, because our time and attention is valuable. And that was how they were monetizing the product. And so, I think it's important. That's where I begin the book. I start right there in chapter one with those stories. And then I sort of take it from there in terms of how the evolution has really informed the way that society and business has changed over the last two decades.
Rob, I want to go back one and then come forward. But so let's go back on this stream for a second. So you're going to go do profiles on these individuals. And the thing you figure out sort of instantly is, like we all are, they're flawed. But some of these individuals are flawed in a sort of not common sort of way. Almost all of them have extremely strong opinions about stuff we care about. And if you go push on those opinions, I think they're not mainstream. If you go ask the average engaged, educated American, which I like to think most people are, and you really press them on some of these issues, politics or economics or philosophy, or just things like that, what you see in this group of people that have enormous power is a very extreme view from a very young age. And I think we need to put a pin in that when we come back. All right, so then we go to the stories that you document unbelievably well. There are now students of these kids. These students are always bright. I mean, they've been bright for 50 years. They're bright today, right then. What is fascinating is people picked up on some of the potential right away. This wasn't a, hey, let's really draw this out. Instant reaction from some of these people were like, hey, wait a minute. We've got some questions we should ask about these. And they get steamrolled. They basically get ignored. This thing just blows up and any warning is completely obliterated. We don't even stop for a second to consider. You might be the only person who has gone back and reflected on those observations.
Let me explain why. Because my job is to teach students how to be great entrepreneurs. That's my job. My job is to meet them where they are, to mentor them and coach them. And I really believe in the power of being able to create your own path and build your own business and make incredible with that, but also change the world, hopefully for the better, hopefully in ways that you'll be very proud of as an entrepreneur. And that's what I teach my students, that you can do it all. You can both be very proud of what you've built and make a lot of money doing it. And I think a lot about the moment when Mark Zuckerberg dropped out of Harvard. Because what he did was he left literally one of the greatest institutions of higher learning, of higher education, in order to pursue his dream. It should be that place is built to help him to seek all of his ambitions. And the mentors and the people who are guiding him, I think, have a responsibility to help him in that. But what was happening in those early moments was that he literally hacked Harvard. It was a cyber attack. He stole pictures of underage kids, many of them women, and posted them without their permission. That was FaceMash. It was a Halloween prank 21 years ago, next month. And what do we understand about that is that there was a real sense that Zuckerberg then was worried that he was going to get kicked out because of the ad board, the administrative board at Harvard. And he left, and then Peter Thiel invests in him. And his mentors become venture capitalists. To be clear, they don't really care about profitability of this business. They care about ubiquity. And that's different.
Rob, I don't want to interrupt, but you know, it's not that Peter Thiel just says, wow, I'm a venture capitalist, I've done a lot of things, and I see this incredible growth in the Facebook I'm going to invest. He actually has another agenda behind it that is triggered, which is he is somebody who wants to spread his view of the world to the world. And it's hard for me to not think that when he saw the Facebook and the growth and the power and the connection and the addiction and all that, he invested, he's a venture capitalist, so he invested in the growth, and this is a young entrepreneur who's 19 years old, but it's really hard for me not to think he saw some other potential right away. And the reason I bring that up is he becomes the most important influence on Mark Zuckerberg. At least
that's true. And I think that's what's interesting is that those who read this book won't get much editorializing from me because I can't get in his head or Zuckerberg's head at that moment. What I do see is their actions, which is that Zuckerberg is trying to convince Thiel and Hoffman that if they don't want to invest in the Facebook, they should invest in WireHog, which was essentially Dropbox. That's what Sean Parker wanted to call it, was Dropbox. If you look at the value of Dropbox, it is an incredible company and is incredibly far smaller than what Meta is today. right? And so the scale is just really, and the time and attention that the students were spending on the Facebook, they were spending hours and hours each day checking the Facebook. And why was that? And I mean, those are the questions that I ask, is what was going on with that of the really smart college students? These were at the Ivy Leagues and at the top schools. That's where they started. These are the smartest kids of that generation. What was so compelling? And I would argue that it was the same thing that FaceMash was, which Mark Zuckerberg coded with his own hands. He coded, were we let in for our looks? Were we let into Harvard for our looks? No. Will we be judged by them? Yes. Click to choose. That's what he coded that night, October 28th. He coded that, and that's what he was asking his peers to do, is judge each other. And they did. They judged each other so much that it shut down the internet to all of Kirkland Hall. And I think today, if we think about what is Instagram, what is Facebook, what are these things that we use all the time? Well, the dopamine that's feeding our brains feeds more judgment as entertainment. And that's the point that I'm trying to make, is that there isn't much that has changed about why we are promoting the best versions of ourselves and why we feel the need for that social affirmation through digital means. I just don't think that that's really us. I don't think it's really who we truly are as human beings. And when we're projecting out an image of ourselves that's better than the true version of ourselves, that's another way of saying a deception. We're deceiving people. We're trying to, at least. Yep. And it's a detachment from what's reality in some sense. And so judgment is entertainment. If you view the company as that, from its very origin story, it shows that that is driving the desire to gain people's attention and to fuel whatever it will take to be able to capture their attention for longer. And as we well know now, because of many studies, and that's all documented in the book, often the most extreme information, often the things that we don't really believe but are curious about and going to click on, it's a little bit off, it's a little bit funny, it's a little bit even conspiratorial, that is what captures our attention on both the left and the right. And I think that that's part of what draws us apart rather than together. I think that the fact that the algorithms maximize some of that, not only extreme thinking, but extreme behavior, and incites anger and incisiveness, all of that is what we have seen play out politically and societally. And there was the business reason to do it, because they didn't want to make short-term profits. They were looking to gain as much of our time and attention as possible, because then they could sell that for advertising. And I think that's a really key point, is that Zuckerberg didn't take classes his junior and senior year in the humanities and trying to understand people's other perspectives and trying to understand that the world is a very complex place without easy answers. I mean, during those years, I'm spending my time debating with people all sorts of issues about the Iraq War and other topics that were really contentious. And I became a better person for it. I became someone who can look at issues from multiple perspectives and who isn't just diving towards my own outcome. And let me tell you where it's gotten us now, Paul, which is that my student.
Wait, go back. Hold one second. I want to go back one second. Hold that. Put a pin in that. That's where I want to go next. But I want to make cool. I want to ask a question. All right. So I'm going to make the statement, and you may push back, which is great, that, you know, the fact that we had an entrepreneur start something that was kind of cool and dropped out of school and then went to the West Coast to get investing, in a sense, there's nothing wrong with that. That's kind of I think it's the mythology part, but that's part of entrepreneurship. Mm-hmm. The fact that some venture capitalists saw the potential in this, nothing wrong with that. I think that setup is, I think we're all saying that's relatively neutral, I think.
Right.
I think what's really important is the people that then take this opportunity and this is what I got from your book. I didn't have this before. I want to give you full credit, but it really hit me, is that they then take this power and they make some decisions that if people knew, even at the time, would, I think many people would find not good. Now, that's a judgment call. But certainly, you know, up to that point, I think the story's sort of innocent, but it's the moment that Mark decides that, and Sean Parker decides that, and Peter Thiel and to some degree Hoffman all encourage it. That's when we go down this path, which now you're about to make. I just want to make this comment. Now we're at this point, 20 years later, where those decisions are having dramatic impact on society today. Now, is that a fair setup?
Yeah. Let me give you, I would love for every Harvard graduate who graduated with Mark Zuckerberg, if he would have actually stayed in school and graduated, to answer this question, which is that Harvard's motto is veritas, truth. Right? How do you feel about Mark Zuckerberg getting an honorary degree for hacking Harvard, dropping out, right? Building something that is literally creating the greatest deceptions, to my argument earlier, right? And they didn't even give him the honorary undergraduate degree that he didn't earn. They gave him a doctorate, their highest honor for that. I think that's just an interesting thing to think about. Now, we all know why. We all are not naive. We know it is all about power and money. Like, that is often the way the world works. And as someone who believes in the academy, who believes in the value of truth and truth seeking, who believes that, like Sergey and Larry early, and you'll get this in chapter two, they wanted to return the internet to the .edus and were decrying how many .coms there were. And that's the reason why they originally didn't want to monetize what was first Backrub and then Google. And if you go back and read their original Stanford thesis, just like I did, they were talking about it being a moral document. They said it would be insidious business to run ads next to answers. Insidious business. That is, it's moral, that's philosophy. That is, they are bringing in their own moral approach to that. And for me, that's what's really interesting, is that Zuckerberg intended to do judgment as entertainment. And we loved it, and he profited from it. Sergey and Larry were saying originally that it would be insidious to run ads next to answers. And then they did it anyways, right? And they came sent to billionaires from having done so. I think that all of this is just really interesting if you go back and look afresh at the original intentions and the trade-offs that were made, and to see it through the lens that these are all choices that real human beings are making at every stage of the development. And I do want to be clear about where we've ended up. Okay, which is
that my students. Yeah, now that's where I interrupted. Go.
Yeah, my students these days both feel like they need to make stronger arguments in a way that bothers me. Now, I try and teach them to be good critical thinkers and not cynical thinkers, and that's really hard these days because it's been proven that their attention spans are getting shorter, and so it's hard for them to focus and go in deep on things. But also, I mean, I asked a room full of Tulane students, and I talk about this in the acknowledgments to lead off the book. I asked them, how do you define research, the word research? And the answer that really bothered me was someone said, research is finding the information to back up what you believe.
Of course. Yeah, confirmation bias. Come on, Rob, don't be naive.
But that's where the world is ending up in a way that really bothers me, because the short-term dopamine hits and the short-term making arguments that are more outrageous, more extreme, all of that has real consequences when essentially this is the world we're leaving to our children, right? This is the way that we think the world should end up being. And I think that's what really bothers me about this technology is a tool, and it's being used as a tool, and it is working in the way that its designers intended it. And the consequences that then we all have a responsibility to reckon with is that we should understand that that's where that's the world we're going to leave to our children if we don't act on it and think very carefully, very, very, like societally, broadly, what does this mean for our world? But also from a business angle, if all of us decide not to click on ads on Facebook or on Instagram for one quarter, it would break the business model of that company. So we're all making
that
choices.
That should be our challenge. That should be our challenge.
In the book, I say that's civil disobedience in some sense, if we choose to do it.
Rebbe, again, I want to go back for and some of you said, I just want to make a fine point of this, which is, you said it twice, two different responses, that this is not inevitable, that the business models, maybe we could argue that once they got going, their scale, their natural monopolies, blah, 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 those maybe are inevitable. But the way they use the power behind the scenes is not inevitable. Those are decisions that were made by people running this. And so when we, the consequence is real, it's documented, and it's more than documented. I mean, it is well known internally and externally. This is not like, oh my God, you've done this research. Wait, tell me. You know, everybody knows this. And it's the consequence of the decisions that people make and continue to make. And we've centered the power in a handful. I don't know, I was trying to count. I don't know, maybe it's 20 people, 25 people, if we really, that are making these decisions again and again and again to get us here. And they made them then consciously. This isn't by accident. There was no mistake here. They then found out that these are bad decisions. They doubled down on the decisions, found out that there's worse consequences, and then doubled down again. I think that's one of the points you're making, is that these are decisions that have been made, reinforced, remade, doubled down again and again. So the fact we ended up here, which is not good, is the conscious, is the result of conscious decision made by a handful of people.
That's correct.
All right.
Exactly right.
If I'm a user of these platforms, I am told again and again that they're free. I don't pay for Google, right? I don't pay for Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp. I don't pay for, they're all free. And that's the big lie, of course, because I don't pay directly, but I pay indirectly. Because the way they take that data, and it's not just they sell that data, they manipulate the data, and then they manipulate my experience in a way that we humans are vulnerable to. I mean, in the same way that if you're sitting there, you're hungry, and somebody puts a bowl of nuts in front of you, this is the famous story that Dick Thaler tells, he went on and got a Nobel Prize in behavioral economics, that if you're hungry and you put bowl nuts in front of you, you know you're not healthy for you, and you know they're going to ruin your dinner, and we can't help it, right? I mean, we are human, we're flawed. And these people reverse engineered our worst tendencies and doubled down for growth.
That's right. Yeah, one of the arguments that I make near the middle of the book is that we thought it was about the technology and it was actually about psychology and sociology. If these were the subjects that that they would have been studying, and Mark Zuckerberg was not a computer science major, right? And so it's interesting when you look back on it, even what he was studying early on. And I think that's right. I mean, I think here's the thing to think about with especially this audience, okay? The modern era, what I call the Silicon Age, I go through the Bronze Age and all the Iron Age early on, I go to the Silicon Age, that's my sort of moniker for it, the digital era, whatever you want to call it. The most valuable asset is essentially our time and attention and our data and content. And I break those up because I think that they're different phenomena. Our time and attention is extremely valuable. What you dedicate your time and attention to is extremely valuable. Netflix, the CEO of Netflix often says their competitor is not Amazon Video or YouTube TV. It's anything else that you would spend your time doing, right? So they're competing with sleep, is what he says, right? And they're winning, was the joke on that one, right? I mean, it literally is, your time and attention is valuable, right? And so if we look at that and we think about these platforms as if they would have existed in any other age, let's pick the agrarian age, right? Your time and attention would essentially be what you were doing on the land, right? It would be the land and who owns the land and who has rights to the land and how you're treated on that land. And let's view data and content a bit differently. It's more like the labor. It's the created product, right? And so data and content, videos and the photos that you're posting, Instagram or Facebook, the data of them geolocating you and surveilling you, that's all content that they are then monetizing as well. That's different. It's a different phenomenon. Let's consider that your cattle or the fruits of the labor, of whatever you're harvesting, right? Now, in the agrarian era, if they told you, you never get to own the land, right? And you can get kicked off the land if we decide that you're not the right person or said the wrong thing in one moment, then you would feel like you're being treated as not as a citizen, but as a serf, right? You wouldn't feel like you actually had any ownership of that, because you wouldn't. And if they came and took your cattle and took all of the fruits of your work, and that was, invisible to you, you wouldn't know how valuable it was. And that would be the analog of what we're talking about here. That would be the analogy of what we're discussing here. That metaphor does hold up. And it's not just me making it. Frank McCourt, who has been very vocal on this with Project Liberty, has been talking about it in similar terms, as has my former State Department colleague, Tamika Tilleman, who's working with him there, and many others in that group. I think that's one of the interesting things, is that people are finally willing to challenge that this world that has developed with the internet and the way it has become in terms of the time and attention and data and content, it doesn't have to be the world we live in. And it actually could be a far more free and fair market if we had at least the ability to share in the value of our data and content, at least the ability to share in the value of our time and attention, or more agency over how that gets used and more clarity and transparency over how that gets used. I think that's worth demanding.
Rob, this is literally the perfect setup for the next theme. So theme one is we have these amazing business models that in and of themselves, there's nothing evil. And they are what they are. They're scale businesses, natural monopolies, and global, potentially, great business. Kind of the second theme is we have the power in the hands of people that consistently make decisions that are probably good for business and incredibly bad for society. We have overwhelming evidence. Bad for individuals, bad for discourse, bad for democracy. I mean, it's bad on like nine levels. We then have this third theme, which is where I really got upset reading your book, which is they're now taking their power and money and they're moving into politics, partially probably driven by the fact that people are waking up and say, wait a minute, maybe these should be regulated to some degree and they don't like that and maybe some worse things. Andreessen said recently that as far as he's concerned, this election is only one issue. There are a lot of people that are one issue people. His issue is crypto. I was like, wait, crypto of all things. That he said, I'm just quoting him. And can you talk a little bit about the evolution of this power and this money now moving into US politics? And you could probably spend an hour on that. And I'd like you, as we get near the end, I'm gonna force you to talk a little about J.D. Vance. So you know where you're headed, but go.
Let's talk. Peter Thiel made headlines in 2016 when after the Access Hollywood tape came out. And so this is after Donald Trump, who, when that tape was recorded, was a married man, was bragging about attempting to assault a married woman, to sexually assault a married woman. That was the moment that Peter Thiel then chose to give $1.25 million to Trump. Now, the weird number, I always, like, again, I look at this with curiosity, like why 1.25? Why not two? Why not one? I go into why in the book. I won't go into it now because it won't get us to the answer we're hoping to really drive towards. But I hope that the audience enjoys at least my speculations on that. And it's all, again, 1,902 endnotes. And so if they want to go in deep on the research, it's fully fact-checked, editorial reviewed, peer reviewed. Columbia University Press did a great job with it. But $1.25 million in 2016, and he was excoriated. Throughout Silicon Valley and in the press, Peter Thiel has lost his touch, is what everyone says at that moment. His bet pays off. He was right. And Trump's elected, and he literally sits at his right hand during the transition. And then we see many people who did not have traditional foreign policy experience, international development experience, hadn't been in the Peace Corps, maybe, you know, even hadn't had business experience other than with Peter Thiel, that were appointed very high levels in our national security apparatus. And so I document all of that. But here's what's interesting, is that 1.25 million was gobsmacking for people at the time. Thiel was literally the top 10 donors to the Trump campaign in 16. Let's fast forward to 2022. J.D. Vance, U.S. Senate candidate. He's in a crowded Republican primary field. Okay, he is fifth in a field of five. Peter Thiel gives $17.5 million to support J.D. Vance's Senate bid. We wouldn't be talking about J.D. Vance as the vice presidential nominee. We would not be talking about J.D. Vance probably at all without Peter Thiel's money working through the system. That's just reality. Because that $17.5 million helped to move him from fifth to first in that crowded field. And how did he do it? Well, what they were doing was they were posting everything that you need to run a multi-million dollar political campaign onto a Medium site. So Medium, the blog site, it was a public medium site, and so it was not technically collaboration with the campaign. But if you use the Internet Wayback Machine like I did and document it, you see that the only entity following that medium site was working with the Vance campaign. And so they got around that law in some sense. And if you look at it, the content that was posted there included best-in-class polling by the same group that did Trump's presidential polling, best-in-class advising, strategic memos, even B-roll video from Vance's campaign events that was then used in future ads. If you look at all of that, the one thing that that voters in Ohio, Republican voters in Ohio, were saying more than anything else made them not want to vote for J.D. Vance. 3-1 margin, they were saying he didn't want to vote for J.D. Vance, was he was a never-Trumper. He was anti-Trump. And that was clear because Vance had said on July 4th, he picked the date on purpose of 2016 in the Atlantic Monthly, that Trump was cultural heroin, that he makes people feel good for a bit, but he won't fix what ails them. We know this well now, like this has been well documented in the media, but J.D. Vance's ability to switch from being a never-Trumper to being so pro-Trump, he said Trump is the best president of my lifetime. He was born when Ronald Reagan was president. That means better than Reagan. This is going against what most traditional Republicans would even, you couldn't have done that a few years before. And I would argue that what is being espoused is not traditional conservatism. It is moving that party in a different direction. And Peter Thiel, on all days, on Halloween Day, October 31st of 2016, at the National Press Club, said that we needed to move beyond the dogmas of Reaganism, even if Trump lost. That was what he was arguing for then. And so I think it's just important to see that all of that I've just described to you right there, Paul, all of that I found by just being curious and paying attention. I didn't interview J.D. Vance. I didn't interview Peter Thiel. I didn't talk to anybody who knew them, right? I literally was just following what was going on and looking at the dollars. And $1.25 million up to $17.5 million from a presidential race to a U.S. Senate race, that is an extremely outsized return for Thiel in terms of what he is getting. It is also what we would call in Silicon Valley exponential growth. And that growth is something I think is well worth paying attention to. It's not just them. You can also look on the other side of the aisle and look at David Plouffe, who again went from working with Obama to then helping Uber strike the deal with the Saudis. And then of course, flips back over and is now advising the Harris campaign. I mean, it is on both sides, and I try to be very fair about Democrats and Republicans, but Thiel Vance is an important story that I think most Americans have not paid attention to.
Yeah, I think, Rob, I think the other thing I picked up in the book, which after I read that, I was like, wow, because I hadn't been paying attention. I didn't know who J.D. Vance was. I read a lot of books. I had not read his book. People had talked about it. There's too many great books to read. It wasn't selecting it. And so I was surprised by that. So I'm reading your book. I read this. And it blows my mind until your comment that, by the way, this is just the one that I documented. And you're sort of, for me at the end, I was like, wow. And then you're like, you burst my bubble by saying, no, this is one. And I was like, oh my God, he's right. This, and both sides, I'm not picking anything here. This is clearly a part of our politics that I think most people don't know nothing about. And then when you bring that to the Facebook and these other social programs that feed us what we want, your students even said it, your research is finding the best arguments to support my position. We're in a really bad cycle now. And since we went from this great business to a business that is being engineered to solicit our worst behavior to, hey, we better now shore up the politics to make sure the game continues. That's why I said I was fascinated by the book and completely depressed, by the way, at the end.
And before we move on from this point, let me show one thing that, again, I just found by looking at the documents, right? I mean, this book is hopefully written in a way that is hopefully even beautifully told. Like, I really try to tell stories in a way.
I liked it.
Yeah. And that's the English major in me. Yeah. And then hopefully it's well documented, well researched, and that's the history major in me. And so, you know, to that point, I went back and looked at the U.S. Park Service, the National Park Service application for the protests in the National Mall that led to the Stop the Steal protest that led to January 6th, the human beings that were actually physically there, who organized to get them there. And what I found was that the same people who had applied for that National Park Service were the same people who created the Facebook group of Stop the Steal. It was the same people.
Yeah.
And so it's very clear to say that that January 6th wouldn't have happened if not for Stop the Steal. And the Stop the Steal online movement, let's remember, was the fastest growing Facebook group in its history, which is to say the fastest growing social movement in history, because people had never been connected like before. And Mark Zuckerberg made the decision to shut that down, but who was informing him? Who was in that room? Folks, Peter Thiel was the chair of governance for then Facebook and now Meta at that point. And that whole story is a fascinating one of even how he got there, because of his conflict with Reed Hastings in 2016 about Trump. That's all documented in the book. And I think that that's just an important point to make, is that Thiel is part of the reason why the group gets shut down. And so these are real human beings making real decisions, is the point I'm trying to make.
Yeah, yeah, but a small collective group making really big decisions. I mean, this isn't committees and thoughtful people. And I don't know, I'm biased, but if you go read their background and what they espouse, they have non-traditional, certainly non-center political positions. I'll let the audience go do their work. It's not hard to do. All right, I would talk to you the rest of the afternoon. We've had a couple of conversations and I would keep this going, but I do want to open it up now to Q&A. We're going to be joined by David Cowan, who is president of the museum, who sort of helped me run the Q&A.
Paul, Rob, good to be back. Audience, please submit your questions. We'll start the first one. Dorian Nunez has a fair number of them, but one of them is, what has been the reception to your book and conclusions? What's the feedback?
Great question, David. Thank you again for hosting this. So people don't read books. I just hate to say it out loud. People don't read books in the way that I thought. It is one of, especially Gate, was one of the top books. We debuted it at the Berkshire Annual Meeting, in part because I really do believe that long-term perspective takes society into account more than some of the venture that we've been discussing, and does so in a more responsible way, a way that I'm going to align sort of my own life towards, because I've learned a lot from the work that, of course, Warren Buffett and others in that ilk have done. So that's where we debuted the book. No accident with Columbia University Press and all that too, in terms of the people who were behind me in this. And, you know, we got a lot of books sold early on, and I was very grateful. Many of my mentors and people who I admire, Walter Isaacson, Marie Slaughter, Jonathan Greenblatt, people who I really respect, all responded very positively to the book. And that's all, their blurbs are all on the back of it now. And then there was like a little bit of like, people don't read books. Like, it's just, I thought this was going to have a huge sort of, you know, splash, especially about J.D. Vance. And, you know, I think that the reality is that that more people, as they read this book, will discover that there are things that they just didn't fully realize, even from what the media is covering, even on his story, as he's the vice presidential nominee. But then the good news is that as more people are reading the book, I'm getting a lot more positive response. I was just in Dallas on Monday and did a couple of events there. I've got Louisville Book Fest coming up. I've got a few others. And so that's what's interesting, is I think that the book is starting to gain some momentum now that people are starting to read it. And as Paul mentioned in the intro, I was very, very grateful that it's one of the top books this year, according to the Society for Advancing Business Editing and Writing, because those are some of the top journalists and some of the top folks in business media who are now reading it and saying, wow, this really deserves people's attention. And so I am very, very grateful to all of you for making the book available for free so that people can delve in.
Yeah, Rob, I'm sorry that writing this book taught you that people don't read books. it's depressing. We're at the Gabelli Center. We're big promoters, and at Buffett, obviously, of value investing. And I think books are one of the greatest value investment in all times. Good books, your book, because I don't know what your retail price is. I buy books without looking at the prices. And too many books. In fact, if I don't have a book delivered each week, Jeff Bezos sends me an email to make sure I'm okay. So I love books. And to get your research, this story for $30, I don't know, to me is unbelievable. I hate to guess how many hours you spent. And yet what I've discovered is people stop reading these treasures that are out there and very affordable. But I was talking to a kid I work with, and his boss had mentioned that his favorite is in the marketing department of a company. His favorite book was I won't promote the book, was X book. And I said to the kid, have you gone out to buy a copy of the book? Your boss just said, this is his favorite book. And he said, no, I don't read. I haven't read since college. And he said it with such pride. That was the part that unsettled me. And so no, I'm sorry that you feel that way. Now, David, here's a question that it was directed towards you, but I'm tempted to add to it. But can the museum describe another time when a comparable group of industrials wielded so much power? I have an obvious one, but I'd be curious. Now, they weren't social media.
I have the obvious one too, which is the Gilded Age what happened post-Civil War. And but today feels so different with the connectivity that you can reach people.
And the scale. And
the scale. So, but yes. And then, what it took was a lot of legislation with the antitrust, Sherman antitrust, to bust up a lot of those companies. I would add on to that, we'd want to ask Rob, is any country getting this right? I mean, how do you feel about the China model and what they're doing with tech?
I feel horrible about the China model, of course. Look, I fundamentally believe that this, what I describe in the book is, if we view our greatest ideals as being pursuing free and fair capitalism, free and fair markets, and also free and fair elections, right? Free and fair. Well, then what that requires is that power is not in the hands of a few, and the wealth is not co-opted and completely wielded by a few. It is available more to all of us. That's the American dream, right? Like, that's what we should be fighting for. And so I would argue that actually we don't look to the China model for sure. We definitely don't even need to look to what Europe's doing in terms of regulating, because the moment you try and regulate something in tech, it'll already be out of date. My answer is we need better capitalism. We need better business. We all need, as consumers, to know that we're voting with our dollars, just to vote with our votes. And we vote with our time and attention.
And our time. Dollars and time.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. I think that for all of us consumers to see that, that's what we need to do, is that we need to learn about this, understand not only what it means for us, but like, even if we're okay with it, is that the world we want to leave to our kids? And then really try and make some tough decisions personally.
I think that that's it. And I don't like I love the answer, but I don't like the answer because it requires personal responsibility. And I don't want to blame a generation, because I'm sure my parents thought my generation was lazy and uninformed, but it tends to happen. But this willingness to take ownership for your own actions, this willingness to take ownership of your content. I always joke that the Instagram life or the Facebook life is we only show the highs, we never show the lows. And yet I think if you ask individuals, it's the lows where they grew the most and developed the most, and grit and kind of character is in the tough times. We've documented that well. But we've encouraged people to only show the good days, only show the good events. That's right. And the impact on young women particularly just drives me crazy, because it's willful negligence, and that has that cascading. I think you quoted it. I've been reading all this stuff now. You sent me down the rabbit hole, but 70% of young women now have felt at least a moment of self-harm. 70% of young women self-harm. I mean, wait, that's worse than an epidemic. And yet it's going on and on. So the answer that we have to take more personal responsibility, I think, is spot on. I worry about that a bit. Hard to do.
It's in chapter one.
Combine a couple questions. Amandeep Kapoor, how do you anticipate social media changing the next 5 to 10 years? And I'm going to add on to Jill Patricott, can you speak to Bill Gates, Microsoft AI initiatives and its impact on power? So where are we going? And can you talk a little bit about AI?
Sure thing. And so where are we going, I think, will be very interesting in terms of, for instance, the TikTok bid. I mentioned Frank McCourt earlier. He's putting in what he calls a people's bid for TikTok. And one of the things that he wants to do is essentially allow people to share in the value of the data and content they're creating, and also make the platform way healthier and way safer than it has historically been towards our children, especially, and put measures in there. Again, we need to do higher psychologists and psychiatrists and trust and safety experts. You need to spend a lot of money on those things because that is what will make the platforms both engaging, but also not so detrimental to young minds. And so I think that that type of a platform, that could hold a lot of promise. And here's what's powerful about that is he wouldn't need the algorithm because the algorithm is what's addicting these kids. He would be able to just appeal to the user base and then build that algorithm anew. And so I find that really interesting and compelling. And again, that's a private market solution in some sense that would allow for that, not a heavy-handed government sort of follow the rules that the government puts out. Now on AI, I closed the book with AI, with actually many of Peter Thiel's warnings about AI, because I do think as much as Thiel, I am concerned about the way he has wielded power, I do give him full credit that he has built things and seen things that others have not. And he is very concerned about AI, about what AI will do. I do think that that what happens next with what AI does to not only social media and what happens in terms of what we see and not knowing what's true or false, not knowing what's real or fake, taking this deception and moving it into where reality doesn't even matter anymore, where truth seeking isn't even the point, where myth making is more valuable than reality, that's really concerning to me for obvious reasons. But I also look at it and I do think that there's so much promise with artificial intelligence. I mean, I see it from even how my students build businesses way more quickly because they're ideating with the knowledge that is available through that. And if these tools are used in the right way, I think they're extremely powerful and extremely, I have a lot of hope for it. And so that's where I look at it. That's the lens I look at it through. And I think there is promise of the fact that we're having a much more robust conversation about the world we want to live in now that AI is starting to come online in ways that it had not been even a few years ago. And I think that those conversations in a democracy are not only healthy, but I actually trust they're going to lead to the right result. I still have hope that our democracy can function in that way. But that's going to take real people making real decisions that may be not always in their immediate business interest, but maybe in the long-term interest for all of us.
Rob, one way that AI probably will repeat is it's a naturally scale business. Training these models is phenomenally expensive, so we're not going to have many of them. They're clearly going to have scale advantages, maybe even some network effects, we'll see. And so the LLMs anyway are going to end up in the hands of only a few people. And right now, two are in the hands of people that have made some not great decisions. So I like the dialogue. I worry about the natural scale, concentration of power, particularly in the hands of the same people. And I don't know. In this case, I think I worry history is going to repeat. Not going to rhyme, going to repeat.
So a couple questions. We always like to know where you come down on crypto. Fan, not a fan?
Yeah, I'm a fan of every new technology, every new innovation that can unlock value. I think one thing on crypto that's worth paying attention to is, you know, as it's being applied in ways that bring real world value, how can we, as business leaders, as investors, think through ways that it could actually support the type of world that we want to live in that I'm describing here? Well, think about it. If I want to share in the value of my data right now, it's really hard for me to be able to do so because I don't know who my data gets sold and resold and resold and resold to. I also don't understand the value of it. Crypto can unlock that in some really powerful ways. And so if we think about not just crypto, but blockchain more broadly, the evil record and ability for us to be able to apply this new technology, relatively new technology, in some fresh ways, could actually unlock a better internet. I mean, I think that's the hope. And so a lot of my friends who are working in Web3 as entrepreneurs, as investors, they actually believe that that's what's possible through the innovations they're bringing to market. I think that's really promising. And so that's how I would look at it is how does this technology, how do the innovations actually advance the world that we want to live in? And here's the key, the existing players, the ones that are addressed in my book, they're not startups. We talk about them like they're startups. They haven't been startups for two decades. They're conglomerates. They are, for things like the robber baron era, right? They're the Standard Oil. They're the large players. I mean, the great thing about America is that we at least need to hope that when given new tools, new technologies, entrepreneurs can create new value and hopefully create something that's different if people want an alternative. And I think so.
Yeah, but it does require a little entry. You got to be able to enter the markets, and when you have concentrated economic power, that potentially can limit that entrance, which makes it harder for entrepreneurs. David, go ahead.
Any thoughts besides like DuckDuckGo or something to how we limit our footprint? Any tricks of the trade you have that you want to share?
Yeah, I'll talk about a really personal moment, which is. When I was working on the book, I was really doing a lot more soul searching about my own use of technology. I want to be clear, I am not a Luddite. I love tech, right? I'm someone who, like, I'm always trying to figure out the new thing. I'm an early adopter. I was coding in HTML my church's website when I was a kid, right? Like, I mean, this is the type of person that I am. But there was a moment where I was, it's when my 7-year-old was probably 3 or 4, which is how old my 4-year-old's four now. And I think back where I was, he did something really funny and I was like, I held out my phone and I was like, oh, do that again. And I recorded it. And I didn't even post it to Instagram, but there was a moment where I stopped myself as I was researching this book and doing some soul searching as well. I was like, what have I become? Like, I'm literally asking my 4-year-old to do something again and changing the way I'm parenting for some dopamine, like for some social recognition. And this is during COVID and I was feeling just detached from the rest of the world. So I can understand, I can have empathy even towards myself in that moment. But I then think about like, how many times have we all been at concerts and when things get really good, we hold up our phones to record a video we're never gonna watch again, right? Like what are we doing? Like we're literally missing out on the best stuff of life in order to be able to hold on to it, but you can't. Like that's part of the way that life is. And so I think a lot of it is really trying to one, think very deeply. And that is one thing where a book is really good for that. You have to sit down with it and you have to delve in and you have to listen to the stories, you know, through the way that the author is telling them. And if you get interested in my book, you flip to the back and you go through the end notes and they're all there. And you can then check out what I was looking at and see if you agree or disagree. Like, does retrain our brain and our experience of the world in a way where, and I love books. I mean, I hope that this book will be that experience for people and allow for that greater depth. It does make you then think twice before you're doing something that is more ephemeral and that is, frankly, not who you want to be. And so I come back on that moment and say, that's not who I wanted to be in that moment. I'll be honest with you that I do it a lot less, but I'm not perfect. I mean, I try and leave my phone when my boys and I are eating dinner completely far away from me so that it's not even a temptation. But we're busy people. And I think that that's one of the things for me is that at least knowing that every decision that we make isn't going to be perfect, but at least trying to be able to move in the right direction. I think that's where that personal responsibility does come in.
So last question before Paul closes, what's next for Rob?
Thanks. Like I said, I'm going to be out at different book events continuing through the fall. But the greatest thing for me is I get to teach and mentor and get students that are fascinated by not only the way the world could be, because they don't love the way that it is in some of these platforms, but they also think they can do it. They think they can change things. That's the real beauty of being able to be a professor, is that you get to see the world through their eyes and then also know that it could be different for them. I trust in that. And so the good news is I'm building a new class. It will be around tech ethics. It was with a fellowship from Yale, which is very grateful for, actually Yale Divinity School, with a program called Life Worth Living. And to Paul's earlier point, they talk about a good life is not just the good stuff that we think of as positive that happened to us. The good life requires suffering. The good life requires introspection. It requires some of this more depth. And that's not just them. That's not just Miroslav Volf, who is the one who pioneered that, and his team. It's actually a whole bunch of philosophers that they all document. And so we'll be teaching out of that book, which is a book about philosophy and religion and theology, and deep thinking about what makes for the good life. And then we'll be applying it to every tech topic that we talked about today and then some. So we'll be going through week by week to make sure that our students, our School of Science and Engineering, our business students, other students at Tulane, are thinking deeply and debating these topics. And that, to me, I mean, that's what can shape the future. I really do believe that.
Hey, Rob, how do I enroll in that class?
I love it, Paul. Thanks.
I would love that. All right, Rob, listen, this was fabulous, truly fabulous. And thank you for writing the book. I think you did an enormous service to society. And people are getting the book. Read it. You get it. You know, now, in this case, it's going to be free. The incremental, read it. I think you'll be shocked by the research, probably a bit shocked by the stories, and perhaps motivated to change your behavior. So, Rob, from all of us, the museum, society, and the center, we cannot thank you enough for spending time with us today.
Thank you.